Architect Jules Hardouin Mansart completed the Gallery de Glaces, or Hall of Mirrors, at Versailles for Louis XIV in 1686. Its restrained Baroque architecture, with amazing interiors by Charles Le Brun, was breathtaking in its majesty, as was the Sun King's intention. Its 17 arched windows were echoed by 17 mirrored archways, which refracted the light and reflected the sky and gardens outside. Today, 60% of the 357 original mirrors are still intact, following a giant $16 million project to restore it that was completed in 2007. From Louis XIV's time onward, this wonderful space was used for receptions, state audiences, and balls, and many great world events have also taken place here, including signing the Treaty of Versailles, which ended the First World War. 20 great chandeliers of silvered bronze, adorned with Bohemian crystal, are a continuing reminder that Louis XIV was the leading light of his generation. The paintings planned by Charles Le Brun have been restored and represent a monumental homage to Louis XIV's military victories in the Dutch Wars of the 1660s and 1670s, portraying him as a person rather than a mythological figure. They are displayed as a narrative moving from war to peace. They were all designed by Le Brun using hundreds of drawings, Veronique Serrano of the restoration team explained. They were then painted on canvas and attached to the vault. To complete the ceilings, Charles Le Brun worked with a team, but we have no knowledge of whether he painted any himself. Each oil is accompanied by a description, which traditionally would be in Latin, but in this case, also for the first time, they were written in French by none other than the playwright Racine and the poet Nicolas Beaulieu. Each oil is accompanied by the date of the event portrayed, and the central painting, The King Governs for Himself, 1661, records the moment in 1661 when, after having ascended to the throne in 1643 at the age of 4 and ruled over by his mother and Mazarin, that Louis finally assumed direct power. The niches hold some of the finest sculptures in the royal collections, and in Louis's day, the gallery was also filled with glittering gilded silver furniture, melted down when the economy wasn't going as well as it should. The decor reconstituted today includes a suite of gilt wood furniture, chosen to celebrate the marriage of the Dauphin to Marie Antoinette in 1770. The 24 gilded candle stands executed from originals in the museum at Versailles. The war room, just off the end of the Hall of Mirrors, has a splendid marble relief of Louis XIV by sculptor Antoine Cossevaux, 1640 to 1720, whose vigorous style was much influenced by Bernini and suited the flamboyant style of the French court at this time. Every day, courtiers would wait in the Hall of Mirrors to see the King and the royal family processing to the Royal Chapel for Mass. Two stories high, the Royal Chapel was dedicated to his illustrious ancestor, St. Louis, and constructed between 1699 and 1708 by Jules Hardouin Mansart, and completed in 1710 by his brother-in-law, Robert de Cotte. The vestibule on the ground floor is adorned with Ionic order columns made of white stone from the quarries at Crotay. On the chapel floor, marble of various colours forms a magnificent carpet with large geometrical compartments. In the middle of the nave, the royal arms, and in the front of the altar steps is the king's monogram, two L's intertwined beneath a crown. The ceiling paintings are a triumphant assertion of the Eternal Father, announcing the coming of the Messiah. The painter Hyacinthe Rigaud captured Louis XIV in maturity, in full Baroque splendour, with his dark complexion and excellent figure, perfect hands, feet and legs, a about which he was extremely vain. He had small but brilliant eyes through which he gave the impression of seeing everything. A large nose was his only salient feature, possibly inherited through his arrogant descendants who had Moorish and Jewish blood. The formal layout in Baroque architecture was calculated to express etiquette and to back up negotiation. The route to the reception rooms was carefully arranged as a deliberate progression. As the visitor was brought along the enfilade to meet the exalted owner at the other end of the intimidating corridor, they would view the splendour of each room as they passed on one side and the view over the garden on the other. All of this gave a distinct impression of the owner's importance, while psychologically contributing to the nervousness of the petitioner or visitor as they approached. It was calculated to reinforce the idea of your place in the world or the class to which you belonged. It deliberately threatened your self-esteem, put you firmly in your place, and elevated the master of the house into a position of power for any negotiation. It was meant to be daunting, and it's interesting to note the ideas behind this design concept are still alive and well today, although often in other guises and formats. A very grand visitor had far more prospects than one less grand as he progressed along the enfilade. If he reached the second antechamber, the room of the king's gentleman, he was considered a friend, and would wait here for the king to awaken before entering his bedchamber, where, along with the many privileged others, he witnessed the king's rising and retiring ceremonies. Although it was only his courtiers who were allowed inside the balustrade, which was not put in place until 1701. The king's bedroom has been restored since 1980. The original looms used to reweave the fabric for the bedspread, the canopy and curtains, as well as the wall hangings in the alcove. The sumptuous fabric was also embroidered in gold and used for the two armchairs set each side of the bed. The carved decor over the bed bore the legend, "France watching over the king in his slumber." Louis had his chamber adorned with fine paintings. 9 were set into the attic between the ceiling and the cornice and supported by Corinthian pilasters. Only 5 of those remain today: St. Mark, St. Luke, St. Matthew, St. John, and a tribute to Caesar with a gar in the desert, which had been added later. Techniques of manufacture advanced considerably for furniture during the reign of Louis XIV. Stylistically, designs were bold, complementing the uncompromising symmetry, grand effects, and studied opulence of the architecture. Among the craftsmen who stood out was André Charles Boulle, 1642 to 1732, appointed royal cabinet maker in 1672. Boulle did not invent, but certainly perfected, a technique using brass and tortoiseshell inlay. This important commode is in the collection of the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York. André Charles Boulle was one of the first cabinet makers to make effective use of gilt bronze mounts. They protected vulnerable parts of the carcass and added a great deal of sculptural beauty to the piece. The three-dimensional acanthus leaf scroll mount on the upper drawer of this commode beautifully echoes the two-dimensional design in the brass and tortoiseshell marquetry. Particularly noteworthy are the female figures at the corners, their feathery matted wings contrasting with their highly burnished faces. The work at Versailles, as it progressed, united the town, the chateau, and the garden, so it was possible to use the walks in the park to go from one part of the town to another. Le Nort built himself a fine house in the town as did many others, employed there over a very long period. To provide for unexpected traffic, three roads were laid out fanwise from the approach, and the place to arms was so huge, Louis was able to review his whole army, which he delighted to do. The garden work continued for 30 years. The relationship Le Nort had with Louis XIV was one of great informality. It is recorded that upon his unexpected arrival one day, the young king dismounted from his horse to greet Colbert, Le Nort and Laveau, as well as others working there for him. All but Le Nort bowed low as the king embraced him, kissing him on both cheeks with a combination of respect, love and enthusiasm. In old age, it was Louis himself who would push Le Nort personally around the gardens in his bath chair. At Versailles, Le Nort used the natural declivity of the land to form a series of terraces, and he hollowed out a vast amphitheatre. He took the points of the compass for his main axis, making a long perspective from the windows of Mansart's gallery de glaces, so that a view extended as far as the eye could see, toward the setting sun. To the north, he sheltered the garden from the cold winds with hedges of chamille, and they continued the line made by stone walls. To the south, he opened the vista to the summer sun across the terrace of the orangery to gain the sun's benefit. During Louis's reign, the orangery sheltered 2,000 orange trees, 1,000 oleanders, pomegranates, and other rare trees. In front of the building, a specially designed wooden tubs contained trees laden with oranges and other yellow citrus fruits or reddish pomegranates. They were brought out of protection each spring and wheeled into their allotted place. Versailles had a limited natural water supply, but it ended up with more than sufficient because Le Nort built a network of reservoirs west of Saint Cyr and a gigantic pump at Marly in 1680, whose 14 enormous water wheels forced the waters of the River Seine up the 162-metre hillside to an aqueduct. This then fed the reservoirs, supplying the gardens with unlimited water for its 1,400 fountains. Mansart constructed the reservoirs in 1673, and they are still in good repair today and are emptied each autumn for cleaning. The gardens with their parterres, pools, sculptures and groves were designed to form a natural complement to the chateau. Le Nort enriched the numerous subsidiary diagonal axes by creating frequent compartments in the gardens, separated by clipped topiary and geometrically disposed clumps of trees, terraces, canals and fountains. Nature was always to be controlled and kept in its place. As this was an age where virtue was admired above all else, the sunflower, the flamboyant giant of the Americas, where it was a sacred food plant of the Prairie Indian, was the perfect flower to become the attribute of Louis the Sun King himself. Giant sunflower vases flanked the Royal Avenue, that is 1,099 feet long and 210 feet wide. It appropriately led to the Pool of Apollo, where a magnificent sculptural group by Jean-Baptiste Tubby depicted the sun god at the start of his daily journey, rising in his chariot from the water amid the spray of fountains accompanied by tritons and dolphins. With the dusk, they came to rest, while the rest of the chateau partied on. Fountains of the Four Seasons were sited at the crossroads formed by the main avenues of the park. The Fountain of Bacchus or Autumn is octagonal in shape, the god crowned with vine branches. The Fountain of Saturn or Winter is circular, the god Saturn aging and sad, lying on a rock covered with icicles, seaweed and shells. The Fountain of Flora or Spring was carved by Tubby, The goddess lay half naked on a bed of varied flowers, surrounded by young cupids playing at weaving garlands, which intertwine and tumble down to the water of the pool. Her hand rests on a basket, brimming over with cornflowers and anemones, and all the flowers of the old gardens of France. 70 sculptors were employed in the garden under the tutelage of Le Brun, and statues throughout the garden depict mythological stories relating to Apollo, including Zeus, the father of all the gods. Louis overindulged his nobles with pleasure, encouraging them to gamble. He held spectacular fêtes. One lasted for a week. Fountains and canals were lit by huge chandeliers suspended behind trees. The gardens lit by torches and Roman candles were set off to colour effects. A flotilla of sumptuously decorated small ships were kept at the ready to take the court on evening excursions on its man-made lakes. The success of the new buildings and gardens, as well as the fantastic parties, provided subjects for writers and conversation. The all-new round table was made fashionable at this time by Louis, who thought they were a clever way of defying protocol, enabling him to place his favourite mistress opposite him rather than at the far end of a long narrow table. The great park that Le Nort contrived covered 14,820 acres and was surrounded by 27 miles of walls. Today it only has 2,013 acres. Originally it had three vistas, the main extending to the west and the lesser ones to the north and south. Each began at a parterre directly in front of the palace and its flanking wings. At the centre stood the Trianon de Porcelain, a fragile building for taking refreshments, covered delightfully in blue and white Dutch Delft tiles. The Trianon de Porcelain was later pulled down and replaced by the Grand Trianon, designed by Jules Hardouin Mansart as a retreat for Louis and his family. It included its own miniature Hall of Mirrors. Its Paris style recalls Italian loggia precedents, and Louis and his family used it often as an outdoor summer dining room. Throughout his long reign, Louis's consort, Marie Theresa, remained infinitely polite and an ornament to his royal pageants. But that is as far as it went. They had six children, five of whom died in infancy. Doctors today would say she was mentally challenged, her mind remaining that of a 12-year-old child. And it was her innocent statement, "Let them eat brioche," when told that the poor couldn't afford bread, that was later attributed by the revolutionary pamphleteers to Marie Antoinette, the sort of comment that would never have been uttered by a lady of Maria Antoinette's sensibility. Maria Theresa died in 1683, and in 1685 Louis married his mistress, the Marquise de Maintenon, in a private ceremony. Her apartment overlooked the royal courtyard and was linked by the loggia to the king's private apartment. She gave him 13 children, of whom he was extremely fond, and he legitimized them all. Three died as infants, with the rest rattling around Versailles for years following his death. Louis had a grand plan. He wanted to offer God a holy Catholic France. On the 18th of October 1685, with the urging of his new wife, he changed the fate of both nations and individuals. He revoked the Edict of Nantes, the treaty put in place by Henry IV that granted the Huguenots or Protestants religious freedom in France. More than 1 million Protestants, 1/20th of the population at the time, were left unprotected, and towns such as Nîmes capitulated to pressure, converting to the Catholic faith in their entirety. By autumn 1685, the Protestants were reduced by three quarters, and within the next few years, over 200,000 of them left France as refugees. The tragedy for France, and the good fortune for other countries, was that the Huguenots were the creme de la creme of France's finest creative talent. Artisans, artists, craftsmen, designers, silk makers, glass makers, silversmiths, including all the workers from Aubusson, who emigrated along with leaders from finance, industry and science. Holland and England in particular benefited enormously by their migration. Late in the 17th century, financial worries, the deaths of friends and important members of the royal family, including his beloved son and heir, made Versailles a gloomy place for Louis XIV. Much of the court were disenchanted, their estates suffering from years of neglect, and they drifted away. It is entirely fitting to end on an extract from the Hymn to Versailles. The ceremonial chariots, the royal marvels, the guards keeping nocturnal vigil, all are gone. You are no longer home to grandeur, slumber and solitude, gods formerly unknown, and the arts of reflection. Today, compose your court.